I'm telling you about some of these historical inconsistencies and anachronisms that researchers have pointed out since the 19th century. Another thing, Moses Horenantsi downplays the roles of the Mamikonian family. He promotes the Pakragunis, and he presents the Pakragunis as having played a more decisive role in Armenian history than the Mamikonians. And this doesn't surprise us, because who was his patron? His patron was Prince Sahak Pakratuni. He was commissioned by Sahak Pakratuni, and therefore we're not surprised that he downplays the role of the Mamikonians and elevates the role of the Pakratunis. By the way, an interesting thing in Moses Horenantsi, History of Armenia, Horenantsi refers to events but doesn't mention sources. Like he says, some unreliable people claim that the Pakradunis are from Armenian extraction, but they're wrong. The Pakradunis are of Hebrew, Jewish origin. So he says unreliable sources claim the Pakradunis were of Armenian origin, but he doesn't mention the names of those unreliable men or unreliable sources. And this is a problem with Horenantsi. He refers to ancient sources but doesn't identify them. But I guess this was the common practice in those days. You refer to a source without mentioning it. Now today you have to be exact. If you refer to a source, you have to mention page number, chapter number, book edition, and so on. But in those days it was common practice to refer to a source, quote from a source, and not mention its without mentioning that source. Then he tells us Mesrop Mashtots was educated under Nerses the Great. Nerses the Great was the great-great-grandson of Saint Gregory. He is the only one who mentions this. Again, this is a claim, this is something that cannot be verified by other historians. And I believe, most people believe that the reason he says that, by elevating the status of Saint Mashtots, he's elevating his prestige, because he was a student of Saint Mashtots. Horenantsi was a student of Saint Mashtots. And if Saint Mashtots was the great-great-grandson, if Saint Mashtots, educated by Nerses the Great, who was the great-great-grandson of St. Gregory, that increases his prestige. Another thing he mentions, he says Emperor Arcadios of the Byzantine Empire gave a section of Western Armenia to King Khosrov. There is no way to verify this. Some have gone to such an extent saying this was a fabrication by Horenantsi. I don't know, but there is no way to prove that Emperor Arcadios gave a sector of Western Armenia to King Khosrov. Or another one, he says the King of Eastern Armenia also controlled Western Armenia. This is again an improbability. It's hard to believe. Some people have called that it's fiction, that the king of Eastern Armenia also controlled Western Armenia. Remember that Armenia was divided between the Persian Empire and the Byzantine Empire. Another thing, which is a problem, he mentions the Khazars. Now, who were the Khazars? They were a semi-nomadic Turkic tribe that moved westward from Kazakhstan to the Crimean Peninsula in Russia, and then they went to eastern Ukraine and also went as far as the northern Caucasus, like Dagestan and Circassia. And in time, they became urbanites. They were semi-nomadic, but in time they became urbanites. Now he mentions the Khazars moving to the Crimean Peninsula. Now that happened in the year 1612 AD, not before. How could a person who died in 490 know about what happened in 610? So, based on these anachronisms, there are some researchers and historians who believe that Horenazi did not live in the 4th century. He lived in the 8th century because he refers to events that happened in the 7th century and 8th century. And so he must have lived at least in the 7th century, but not as early as the 4th. This is a problem, isn't it? Well, I've solved this problem. I've solved it for myself in my own mind. The original manuscript doesn't exist, right? The earliest one we have, the earliest copy that we have of Horenazi's work comes from the 14th century. So I believe that Moses Horenazi lived in the 4th, 5th centuries, and he recorded the history of the Armenian nation from Haiknabir until his time. Later on, in the 7th century or 8th century, somebody picked up Horenazi's manuscript and added to it the events that happened in Armenia or that touched the Armenian nation. And did not mention his name, and I would call him pseudo-Horenazi. So there is a real Horenazi who lived in the 4th and 5th centuries, and there is a pseudo-Horenazi. Pseudo, you know, yet, who picked up the manuscript of Horenazi and added to it the events that happened after Horenazi's death. I believe that's exactly what happened. So, the anachronisms are solved, but the historical inconsistencies remain a big problem. Horenazi tells us that Cyrus the Great, who was the founder of the Persian Empire, had a Median father-in-law. Cyrus the Great's father-in-law was a Mede. And Cyrus the Great overthrew his father-in-law, the Mede, whom Herodotus called Astyages. Now, Horenazi says that an Armenian king Dikran, he doesn't say first, second, or what. He says an Armenian king Dikran helped Cyrus the Great overthrow his father-in-law, who was a Mede, and he calls him Ajdahag. Now, Ajdahag in Armenian means a serpent man or a dragon man. This means he was a contemptible person. This fellow was a contemptible person. But which Dikran helped Cyrus the Great? If it's Dikran the Second, well, Dikran the Second lived 55 BC. Mm-hmm. Cyrus the Great lived 4th century BC. So again, here you have a historical inconsistency.
Confusion.
But the greatest historical inconsistency I reserve to the very end. Horenazi says that he researched the Parthian royal archives in the city of Nineveh. The Parthian royal archives are kept in Persia, not in Nineveh. Nineveh was the capital of Assyria. And this is the problem. When was Nineveh destroyed? The Babylonians destroyed Nineveh in the year 612 BC. And their archives, the Assyrian archives, were buried under the rubble and stayed there until the 9th century when they were excavated. And the Assyrian archives were excavated only in the 19th century. And they don't contain the Parthian royal, any information about the Parthian kings. So this is the greatest historical inconsistency that we find in Horenazi. This one is beyond solution. I cannot conceive of a solution for this problem, that he had researched the Parthian royal archives in Nineveh. Nineveh was destroyed in 612 BC, and their archives remained under rubble until they were excavated in 19th century. Now, regardless of these flaws, Horenanzi's importance cannot be diminished. There were other historians of his time, for example, Akatangelos. Akatangelos, of course, this Akatangelos was a pen name. We don't know the real name of the historian. Akatangelos he wrote the history of the conversion of the Armenian nation into Christianity. All right. So there's Akatangelos, and then there's we have Papoustos Pouzant, who wrote about church-state relations in the 4th century. We have Yerishev, who wrote the history of the Armenian revolt against Persia and the Battle of Vartanants. We have Goryun, who wrote The Life of Saint Mesrop Mashtots. We have Hazar Parbetsi, from the who lived around 500 AD, and he wrote about the last years of the Arshavunid dynasty. And by the way, Hazar Parbetsi was commissioned by Vahan Mamikonyan. So you see, Hazar Parbetsi was commissioned by Vahan Mamikonyan, whereas Horenanzi was commissioned by Prince Sahak Pakrakin. So we have all these historians, but Horenanzi was the most quoted Armenian historian from the 8th century until the 18th century. So all Armenian historians, theologians of the Middle Ages quoted profusely from Horenanzi. Horenanzi is the most profusely quoted Armenian historian. And I believe he's important because he was the only historian, Armenian historian, who recorded the Armenian legends and mythology of the pre-Christian era, but he also interpreted them. Like when Horenanzi tells us about the battle between Haik, Nahabed, and Per. He tells the story, then he gives a moral lesson. He says, from this we learn how a small nation can resist the tyranny of an oppressive empire. That's a lesson, isn't it? That when he tells the story of Shamiram and Araki Retzik, he says, from this we learn that virtue conquers vice. See, he not only tells these legends, but he draws moral lessons from them. So that's why I believe he's very important. There's a fellow called Frejner Sesyan. He was the curator of the Christian Middle East section of the British Library. And he believes that Horenanzi lived in the 4th, 5th centuries. And he mentions two reasons. First of all, he says, if Horenanzi lived in the 7th, 8th centuries, he would have said something about the Arab invasion of Armenia, the Arab invasion and occupation of Armenia, which occurred in the 7th century. And then there's no echo of the Chalcedonian controversy. Armenian clergy, and remember, Moses Horenanzi was a clergyman, he was a bishop of Pakrevan. The Armenian clergy were preoccupied with the Chalcedonian controversy from the year 451 until the end of the 8th century. And you find no echo of that controversy in Horenanzi, which means that he lived in the 4th, 5th century. Didn't know anything about this Chalcedonian controversy. You know, this Chalcedonian controversy, it still affects us, or it affected us really hard, in a very hard way in the from the 8th century until the end of the Dark Ages. The Armenians did not attend the Council of Chalcedon because it convened in 451 and the Armenians were busy fighting the Persians. The Battle of Partenons was in 451. The Armenians sent delegates to three ecumenical church councils, the Council of Ephesus and Nicaea, but they did not send any delegation to the Council of Chalcedon because they were busy fighting the Persians. And during this Council of Chalcedon, representatives from all other churches said that Christ had two natures, human and divine, and these two natures are united in one person. And the Armenians rejected this formulation. They did not accept it. The Armenians said Christ's humanity and divinity united, or Christ's humanity was absorbed in his divinity. And so they said Christ has one nature, not two natures. Chalcedon says Christ has two natures, human and divine. And the Armenians said, no, we don't accept that. Christ had one nature. His humanity was absorbed in his divinity. So that's why they call us monophysites. They call the Armenians monophysites, believing that Jesus had one nature. And the Greek Orthodox called us heretics. The Roman Catholics called us heretics. And it was during this time that, you know, if you study the history of the Armenians in Jerusalem, there's evidence that at one time in Jerusalem we had 70 monasteries. 70 monasteries in the Holy Land. And most of them were destroyed by the Greeks because they believed we were heretics by rejecting the formulation about Christ's nature during the Council of Chalcedon. So it cost us dearly. We were, in the eyes of the Greek Orthodox and the Roman Catholics, we were heretics. Schismatics, heretics, were denounced as such. And I remember once in Kansas City, I had a very close friendship with a Greek Orthodox priest. And he would invite me to read the scriptures in Armenian during his Mass, especially at Easter time, you know, he would have the Gospel of the Resurrection read in 8 languages, and he wanted me to read it in Armenian. Okay, they read it in Russian, Serbian, Bulgarian, English, French, and I read it in Armenian. Okay, he told me that he would not administer communion to me. If I requested communion, he would not let it. Why? Because you rejected the Council of Chalcedon, you're heretics, you're not in communion with us. See, even to this day, it comes up. The Horenati's work was first printed in 1695 in Amsterdam. The second edition was printed in 1736 in London. The third edition was printed in 1752 in Venice. And in 1841, Horenati's History of Armenia was translated into French and Italian. In 1893, it was translated into Russian. So, there are some, as I said, historical inconsistencies in Horenati that we cannot solve. And it would be foolish to defend untenable positions. It would be foolish to say that there are no errors in Horenati. That would be foolish. That's untenable. We have to admit there are some historical inconsistencies, but the value of his work as a whole is never diminished.